And open up, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. As I said just a moment ago, it's good to be back. We did have a good trip. It's nice to get away, but it's also nice to get home. It's funny, on a vacation, when you leave, when you first leave, you're sort of like sad about it, right? Oh man, my vacation's over. And then at some point, you get hopeful for home, don't you? And then you just want to get home. We got stuck actually between Toledo and Dayton on the highway on I-75 North. Some semis had actually driven off the road, and like we parked, turned the car off, and sat there for about an hour and a half while they brought in these big cranes and big cranes to literally lift these semis out of the side of the road and so forth. So by that time we were ready to be home. I'll tell you that. By the time we got home. In preparation for I am wearing this mic, and I just want to mention it, I have not taken the practice of wearing pocket protectors, so in case you're wondering, okay, we're experimenting with a new mic for the adult Sunday school class with Norm, so that's what that is. We just want to make sure we get good audio and so forth on those recordings. So anyway, all that being said, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, when we were last together 2 weeks ago, we looked at the second half of verse 17. Paul, let's read these and have a word of prayer. Verse 17, "For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for your word. We're grateful for the opportunity to be back and to be teaching your word this morning. And for these members of the church, the body of Christ here that comprise Grace Life Bible Church, we're grateful for them, for their fellowship in the gospel, and for the time we're going to enjoy after this in food and other kinds of fellowship. But as we come to your word this morning and we have the fellowship of the preaching, we pray that there'll be edification and that you'd get the glory out of this time together. In Christ's name, amen. So last Sunday, or 2 weeks ago, when I was last here, we looked at the second half of this verse, and that message was titled, "Not with Words of Wisdom." And we looked at the second half of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 17, and in doing so, we identified, if you look at that verse, it says, "For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel." So we studied in detail about the first half, about Christ not sending Paul to baptize, but to preach the gospel. And then we looked at the second half of that verse where elaboration is given on how that gospel is going to be preached. It's going to be preached not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. And so that's what we were talking about 2 weeks ago when we were last together. Furthermore, as part of that study, we observed that there are two types of wisdom dealt with in the Bible. The first type is the wisdom which belongs to men. And the second type is the wisdom which belongs to God. If you look with me just very quickly, look at verse... I get ahead of myself, I'm sorry. When you look at verse 17, it says, "Not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect." So the question that I posed a couple weeks back was the following. Which type of wisdom is Paul talking about in verse 17? Which type of wisdom has the capacity of making the cross of Christ of none effect? The wisdom of man or the wisdom of God? The wisdom of this world, or the wisdom that originates and comes from God Almighty? Well, I think the obvious answer to that is that it would be the wisdom of who? It would be the wisdom of men. It would be the wisdom of this world. That's the wisdom that would have the capacity of taking the gospel of Christ about the cross work of the Lord Jesus Christ and making it of none effect to those who hear it. Okay? Drop down with me. Just look quickly at verse 20. It says, "Where's the wise? Where's the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of what? This world." So right there in that context, in verse 17, he talks about the wisdom of words. And then in verse 20, he talks about the wisdom of the world. The world has a wisdom. The wisdom that the world has, as we'll see next week, has nothing to do with God. And we'll find out that God in His wisdom has structured things in such a way so that man, through man's wisdom, will not know God, will not find God, will not know God. And you're going to have to come to God in the way that God says to come to Him, right? Can you come to God by building idols of stone, metal, or anything else and worshiping them and have God accept you on that basis? Are there men that think you can? Quite a few of them, in fact, right? So God has devised a situation where man, by his own wisdom, cannot know God, cannot find God. And we'll talk more about those verses here coming up in the future, next week. So Christ, did not send Paul to preach the gospel with wisdom of words, because doing so risked making the cross of Christ of none effect. And we talked about this 2 weeks ago. Paul worried that the wisdom of words in verse 17 will void or cancel out the power of the cross work to save men from their sins? The answer is what? No. Can any man cancel out the power of God through salvation through the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ? No. But can man's wisdom and man's words obscure the preaching of that gospel? Okay? Can you preach the gospel in such a way, using the wisdom of words, using the wisdom of the world, that would risk making the cross of Christ of none effect? And so we talked about that last time. So all that being said, as we think about verse 18 this morning, I want to look at three general points about verse 18. The first point I want to talk about is the preaching of the cross in Paul's epistles in general. Okay? The second thing I want to talk about is the preaching of the cross during the early Acts period. And the third thing I want to talk about is the preaching of the cross specifically here in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. So without any delay, we've got a lot of ground to cover. I want to get right into this with you here this morning. So look at verse 17. Let's read verse 17 again into verse 18. Verse 17 says, "For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel." Okay, so we've talked about that. "Not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect." We've talked about that. Verse 18, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." Now, I want you to think about that for a minute. The reason why the wisdom of words in verse 17 possesses the capacity of making the cross of Christ of none effect, okay, the reason why that's the case is because according to verse 18, the gospel Paul preached had everything to do with the preaching of what? The cross. Look at how these verses are written together. "For Christ sent me not to baptize," verse 17, "but to preach." We've went over that. What did Christ send Paul to do? Baptize or preach the gospel? Preach the gospel. As Paul goes out to preach the gospel, as he goes out to do what Christ sent him to do, you look at the next part of verse 17, "not with wisdom of words." So as Paul goes out to preach the gospel, what Christ had for him to do, is he to do that and discharge that by using the wisdom of words or not the wisdom of words? What's the verse say? Not using the wisdom of words, right? Why? "Lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect." So when the gospel is presented using the wisdom of this world or the wisdom of words, there's an inherent risk of canceling out, in the understanding of the hearer, what the true power of the gospel is, okay? The true power in the gospel that Paul preached has nothing to do with the eloquency, nothing to do with the words that are being used. It has everything to do with the fact that the cross work of the Lord Jesus Christ is being what? Is being preached. What Christ gave Paul to do is to preach a gospel, and the gospel that he was to preach has everything to do with the cross work of the Lord Jesus Christ. So much so that in verse 18, look at verse 18, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish" what? Foolishness. See, the wisdom of words can never make of none effect what Christ accomplished at the cross. However, they can make the cross's message of none effect if they interfere with the simplicity of the cross and its message. Paul clearly identifies for you in verse 18, so I'm moving into my first point here, okay? In verse 18, Paul calls the gospel that Christ sent him to preach in verse 17, he calls it the preaching of the cross in verse 18. Verse 17, it says, "Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel," right? Then you have the statement in verse 17, "not with wisdom of words, lest what be made of none effect?" The cross of Christ, right? Then you get to verse 18, and it says, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness." If you could summarize the message that Paul was given to preach, the message that Paul was given to preach there is summarized for you in verse 18, and it's called the preaching of what? The cross. Paul's gospel, the good news that had been given to Paul to preach by the ascended, resurrected, glorified Jesus Christ, has everything to do with the cross work of the Lord Jesus Christ, so much so that Paul explicitly calls it the preaching of what? The cross, in verse 18. Now, fundamentally, at its most basic level, Paul's message and ministry extol, make known, proclaim the good news of the cross work of Christ. Now, this happens in a lot of different ways. Let's look at some verses together here. First, you're in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Look at verse 23. He says, but we preach Christ how? Crucified. Okay? When Paul goes out to preach Jesus Christ, he preaches Jesus Christ how? Crucified. Why? Because what he's been given to preach is called, in verse 18, the preaching of what? The cross. Come with me, look at chapter 2, look at verse 2. Chapter 2, verse 2. Notice, he says, for I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him what? So again, do you get the idea here that Paul is honing in on, zeroing in on this issue of the preaching of the cross? Okay, he determined amongst them in Corinth to know nothing among them save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Now come with me to Galatians chapter 4, or sorry, Galatians chapter 6. Come over to Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6, look with me at verse 14. Now, folks, we're just going to look at a few verses here, okay? There's more that we could look at with respect to this particular issue. But look at verse 14. He says, but God forbid that I should glory, save where? In the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice, by whom the world is crucified unto me and I unto the world. Paul's glorying is not in himself. It's not in his converts. It's not in anything. He says, save that I should glory in the cross of who? Jesus Christ. The reason he glories in the cross is because the fundamental, essential message surrounding everything that Paul taught, now listen to me, not yes for justification, yes for a man being made right with God and being saved and having eternal life and possessing eternal security and being sanctified in Christ Jesus. Yes, the cross is about that message too. But as we're going to see as we go through these verses, the preaching of the cross extends beyond just what you need to believe for your initial justification and salvation, and it extends beyond that to include everything that God Almighty, that the Godhead is seeking to do and seeking to accomplish today through the formation of the church, the body of Christ, and the revelation of the mystery. All of it is encompassed under the title or under the terminology, the preaching of what? The cross. So the preaching of the cross is not just your and my initial salvation. It's not just our initial justification. As we'll see, it includes far more than just that. Come with me to Ephesians chapter 2. Come over to Ephesians chapter 2. Look with me at verse 16. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 16. Talking here, we understand verse 11 and 12, he talks about time past. In verse 13, he starts talking about the time we live in now, the but now time period. And with respect to that time period, look at what he says in verse 16. He says, and that he might reconcile both, that's Jew and Gentile, both unto God in one body. How? By the cross. See, what is the pivotal issue in the formation of the church, the body of Christ? It is the cross work of who? The Lord Jesus Christ. It is based upon the complete, total, and accomplished work of Christ at Calvary that God is even able to form the church, the body of Christ, to begin with. And he's able to reconcile to himself both Jew and Gentile in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. See, it's the cross of Christ that is the basis for the formation of the church, the body of Christ. So this issue is, yes, your justification, my justification, our eternal eternal life is part of the preaching of the cross. But the preaching of the cross extends far beyond just that issue, and it includes all of the mechanics upon which God is able to do what he's doing today in the dispensation of grace. Look at verse 13 quickly. But now, in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off, who's that? Who was it that was far off in time past? The Gentiles. Ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh how? Where did he shed his blood? On the cross. How did he reconcile both in himself in one? He did it in verse 16 through the what? Through the cross. The cross is the pivotal feature and issue in all of Paul's preaching. That's why he calls it the preaching of the cross. It includes justification, but it includes other issues related to what Paul has to say. Come to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Just want you to see again the usage of this. Verse 8, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of what? The cross. You understand that the Old Testament says, cursed is every man that hangeth on a tree. When Jesus Christ, when he was crucified for the sin of the world, for your sin, for my sin, for everybody's sin, they nailed him to what? They nailed him to a cross, they nailed him to a tree, right? And as he hung there, he became identified with your sin, my sin, and the wrath, the full wrath of God against sin was poured out upon the Lord as he hung there on the cross, and to so much so that God the Father forsakes his Son, right? Jesus Christ, as he hangs there, he says, my God, why have you what? Forsaken me, right? We understand those issues. We've studied all those issues before here in the past. But it all deals with the preaching of the cross, the death of the cross. Now, look at verse 9. Wherefore? Anytime you see the word wherefore, you need to ask yourself why it's there, right? Wherefore? Wherefore on the basis of what? On the basis of the death of the cross, wherefore God hath also highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. It is the death of the Son of God upon that cross that results in his glorification. Okay? It results in you and I ultimately being made a member of his body, according to Ephesians chapter 2. And it results with us being fitted and made meet, according to Colossians, to be partaker of the inheritance with the saints in light. And it all centers around the cross work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come to Colossians chapter 1. Look at verse 20. He's talking here about the reconciling of all things in heaven and earth. Verse 20, and having made peace through what? The blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say whether they be things on earth or things in heaven. So the accomplishment of the eternal plan and purpose of God to center all things in heaven and earth under the headship and the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ is part of the message that Paul identifies and calls the preaching of what? The cross. It is all accomplished and is all part of the cross work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come to Colossians 2. Look at verse 14. Colossians chapter 2, verse 14. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. What's he talking about there? He's talking about the Mosaic law of time past. It says it was blotted out. Blotted out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us. Now watch this. And took it out of the way. How did he take it out of the way? Nailing it to what? The cross. The Lord Jesus Christ satisfied upon the cross the righteous requirements of the law. So we think about all these things that the cross accomplished. Does the cross accomplish our justification? Yes. When we believe Christ died for our sins upon the cross and rose again, do we receive the free gift of eternal life? Is that part of the preaching of the cross? Absolutely is, right? But is the preaching of the cross more than just that? The preaching of the cross is Paul's phrase to refer to the totality of everything that he has been given to preach, everything that he has been given to write about, that includes God's plan and purpose in how he's going to form the church, the body of Christ, initially, and what he's going to use the church, the body of Christ for in the ages to come. All of that is under the umbrella terminology of the preaching of the cross, because those are all things that were accomplished by what? The cross. Come back with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Verse 18. So if you're taking notes, verse 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but to us which are saved it is the power of God. So the preaching of the cross in Pauline theology then is not limited to justification, to the justification of sinful men before God. Rather, it encompasses the entirety of the mystery regarding God's plan in forming the body of Christ in the first place. Come with me, if you would, to 1 Corinthians 2. Come over to 1 Corinthians 2 and look at verse 7. We just read in verse 2 first. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him what? So folks, when Paul originally was in Corinth, did he preach them the bare bones? Did he preach them the basics? Yes. Okay. Verse 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a what? When Paul speaks the wisdom, notice it explicitly says the wisdom of God how? So in God's own wisdom, he saw fit to keep what? A secret. To keep a what? A mystery. And he says, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained when? Before the world began. Or before the world, excuse me, ordained before the world unto our glory. So when the time comes for God to reveal this mystery, is he shocked? Is he surprised? Or is he just doing what he determined to do before the world began? So in other words, does the Godhead know about this mystery before Genesis 1:1? Yes. Okay. They know what they're going to do. They have it worked out. They had an eternal life conference. They had it all settled. They knew what was going to happen. And they knew how they were going to accomplish what they needed to accomplish. Now watch verse 8. Which none of the princes of this world knew. Now watch. For had they known it, they would not have won. Think about what Paul's saying. The preaching of the cross encompasses everything that he accomplishes. If they'd known about the cross, was the cross a secret? Does the Old Testament predict that Israel's Messiah would die? Yes, right? What it doesn't predict is that through the death of that Messiah, God would turn and set Israel aside and offer salvation to all mankind without what? Distinction. If they had known about this mystery, they wouldn't have done what? They would not have crucified Christ. If Satan and his minions had known about the mystery of the wisdom of God and the mystery, they never would have crucified the Lord of glory. Come with me to Colossians chapter 2. We had some visitors with us 2 weeks ago. And I was asked a question that, unfortunately, I didn't have time to answer adequately at that time, related to why don't more churches see this message? Why are Grace churches so few? And when they do exist, why are there so few people seemingly to be a part of them compared to other things that you see out there in denominational Christianity? Colossians 2, look at verse 14. We already read verse 14. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, they took it out of the way, nailing it where? To his cross. Look at the next verse. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. How did he triumph over principalities and powers? How did he put them to open shame? He triumphed over them and put them to open shame by what he accomplished where? At the cross, right? And through the revelation of the mystery, through the wisdom of God in a mystery, through the now manifestation of what God intended to do from before the foundation of the world, now revealed, it puts the principalities and powers in the heavenly places to open shame and demonstrates how the Lord Jesus Christ is ultimately going to triumph over them and how everything is going to be centered in the Lord Jesus Christ in the dispensation of the fullness of time. Now let me ask you a question. If you are the enemy, do you want people to know that?
No.
And so what Satan has done is he has put down a facade of false doctrine. He's put his booby traps out there for people to step into and get ensnared and thereby never understanding the fellowship of the mystery. Why are there so few and why are there so few in these churches? Why are there so few churches and why are the churches generally not large? Because there is a satanic policy of evil to obscure the truth of what God is doing today. And the reason it's for that is because, listen, if you do something embarrassing, do you want me parading it all around town all the time? So how do you minimize the embarrassment? You minimize the embarrassment by just not having people talk about it. You hear what I'm saying? All of it, the spoiling of principality and power, the putting them to open shame, and the triumphing over them is all accomplished through what? The cross. If Satan knew, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7 and 8, about the revelation of the mystery, they would not have crucified who? The Lord of glory. Come back with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. So what we learn, folks, verse 18, for the preaching of the cross is them that perish foolishness. So what we learn is that not only does the preaching of the cross include everything Paul taught, from the simplicity of the gospel that God would justify mankind today by grace through faith in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, but also up to and including God's plans and purposes in revealing the mystery and forming the church, the body of Christ in the first place. All of that whole totality of information is all part of what Paul calls the preaching of the cross. Now, admittedly, when he comes into Corinth, he limits his preaching with these folks to just the bare bones, the basics, okay? In Paul's mind, now here's the question. In Paul's mind, do you get the idea that the preaching of the cross is a good thing or a bad thing? Is it a good thing or a bad thing? It's not just a good thing. It's the best thing ever. Right? It's not just, that's pretty good. You know, my dad's a guy of few words. You ask him anything, do you like that meal? That's all right. He says that about everything, right? And I, of course, get accused of that from time to time myself, but When Paul is talking about the preaching, read the verse. For the preaching of the cross is of them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it's the what? It's the power of God. Is this something Paul's sort of like, I could take it or leave it? Or is this something that is exciting to him? Is this something that sort of fires him up and gets him going and motivates him? Because Paul knows that what he has been given to preach is in itself the power of God unto what? Salvation. Because the thing that the Godhead had given Paul to preach is the preaching of what? The cross. Now I want to go down to my second point and contrast this with you with the preaching of the cross in early Acts. Come with me to Acts chapter 2. So in Paul's mind and ministry and message, is the preaching of the cross front and center? Is it something that he's excited about? Is it something that he wants the Corinthians and therefore us and all the other churches that he writes to know about and all the different parts and aspects and pieces of the preaching of the cross? The answer to all those questions is yes, yes, and yes, right? Okay? Now, many within denominational Christianity will and function with the understanding or the belief that there's only one gospel in the Bible, And that throughout the entire Bible, that the cross has always been preached by everybody in the Bible as the basis for justification. Okay? Well, we want to look at a few things here. Look with me at Acts chapter 2, verse 22. This is Peter now, one of the 12 apostles that the Lord chose during his earthly ministry, addressing the nation of Israel on a Jewish feast day, after he has just said that a prophecy from Joel chapter 2 has been fulfilled in their ears and in their hearing and in their sight with respect to Joel chapter 2 and the coming of the last days for the nation of Israel. Now look with me, verse 22. Peter says here, "Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as yourselves also know, being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. Now watch, ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain." Ooh. So is Peter glorying in the cross work of Christ when he says that? Is Peter preaching that as something to Israel, that they should glory in the cross work of Christ with respect to this? Or is Peter holding the nation accountable for killing their prophesied Messiah? So, in this context, in time past here, if you're Israel, is the fact that Christ has died, according to this preaching that is made known at this time, is this a good thing or a bad thing? Okay, now we understand, does God have to die for the sin of Israel ultimately? The answer is yes, right? But in terms of them being responsible for the death of their Messiah, is Peter holding them responsible here? Verse 24, "Whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it is not possible that he should be holden of it." Drop down with me if you would, same chapter, look at verse 36. "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus," now watch, "whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ." Who crucified him? Is Peter glorying in the cross? Is Peter calling Israel to glory in the cross? Or is Peter telling Israel, look, folks, there's a problem here. The problem here is that you guys messed up. You didn't accept who he was. You didn't accept the signs, miracles, and wonders that demonstrated who he was. You didn't accept any of that. And now there's a problem because you've taken and crucified the one that was predicted. Come with me to chapter 3. Verse 12. Peter preaching again. "And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, Ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, have glorified his son Jesus, whom ye," here it is again, "whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate, when he was determined to let him go." Could Pilate find any fault in him? No. And were they so intent and bent on him being put to death that they wanted Barabbas to be released to him instead of Jesus Christ? So who is responsible here? Look at the next verse. Verse 14. "But ye denied the Holy One and the just, and desired a murderer be granted to you." Verse 15. "And killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are all witnesses." So what has Israel done with respect to the Prince of Life? They've killed him. Are they glorying in the cross? Is Peter preaching the glorious message of the cross that Paul was preaching? No, he's holding Israel morally culpable and responsible for the death of their what? Messiah. And he's ultimately, as we'll see in a moment, going to call them to repent, to have a change of mind, to have a change of heart about who the Lord was, and make themselves and get themselves right, if you will, with respect to what God was doing in Israel at that time. Come with me, if you would, to Acts 7. Peter's not the only one to say this. Stephen says it as well. Acts 7, verse 51. Acts 7, verse 51. "Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears,
You do always resist. If you're new with us, when he calls them stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, what's he calling them?
Gentiles.
He's saying, you bunch of uncircumcised Gentiles. Woo! And you wonder why they wanted to kill him with stones. Okay? He's like insulting their mama here, right? Okay? Verse 52. Which of the prophets have your fathers not persecuted? And they have slain them, which showed before of the coming of the just one. Who's the just one?
Christ.
Who predicted the coming of the just one? The prophets that they've slain and persecuted, right? Verse 52. And they have slain them which showed before the coming of the just one. Now watch, of whom have been now the betrayers and what? What did they do with the just one? What did they do with the Prince of Life? Is Stephen saying to the Sanhedrin, oh, praise God for the cross? He's saying, you guys what? You murdered the Prince of Life. You murdered the just one. Verse 53, who received the law by the disposition of angels and not kept it. See, what's Israel's response to this? What is their response? What Peter's preaching it, Stephen's preaching it. What is the appropriate response to this message? As I said already, is the preaching of the cross in these verses a good thing or a bad thing? In these verses, the cross is being preached to Israel as a sin for which they need to what? Repent. Okay? Go with me back to Acts 2. Acts 2, verse 36, we already read this. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made the same Jesus, whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. Look at verse 37. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and they said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? And then Peter said unto them, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Peter said, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and not of yourselves, the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. No, what did Peter say? Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. See, what Peter does is he gives them the dispensationally appropriate answer to their question. Their question was, oh my goodness, we realize yes, you're right, Peter. We killed the Prince of Life. We did this thing. What should we do about it? What's Peter's answer? Repent and be baptized for the remission of sin. Does he give them the dispensationally appropriate answer that he should have given them?
Yes.
Go to chapter 3. Chapter 3, verse 15, and killed the Prince of Life. We already looked at that. Verse 17, and now, brethren, I wot that through ignorance ye did it, as also did your rulers. But those things which God before, by the mouth of all his prophets, that Christ should suffer, he has so fulfilled. So in other words, has the suffering of Christ predicted in the Old Testament and been fulfilled as of Acts 3?
Yes.
Yes. Verse 19. What's their response? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Repent ye therefore and be what? Converted, that your sins may be blotted out. What's the next word? When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. See, what Peter is doing here is he is not glorying in the cross. He's not preaching the preaching of the cross the way Paul preached it. He is holding Israel morally responsible for their part in the death of their Messiah. Compare that with me. Go to Acts 13. This isn't in the PowerPoint, but that's fine. I challenge you sometime to do a study. Take Acts chapter 2 and Acts 13. Study Peter's address to the Jews on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2 and compare it with what Paul preaches in Antioch, Pisidia in Acts chapter 13. You will notice they both cover virtually the same issues, but that the conclusion they come to is radically different. Verse 37. But he, whom God raised again, saw no corruption. That's Jesus Christ. Now watch. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man, who's that? Is Christ, is preached unto you the forgiveness of what? Sins. What's Paul doing here? Paul in Antioch Pisidia in Acts 13 is taking the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, and he's now teaching it to the people, not as something that they need to repent for so that the kingdom will come. He's teaching it as something that will forgive them of their what?
Sins.
Verse 39. And by him all that believe are what? Justified from all things which he could not be justified by what?
The law of Moses.
See, Paul's emphasis is on the cross. His emphasis is on all that Christ accomplished at the cross. Peter and Stephen and others during the early Acts period, their emphasis is not on glorying in the cross work of Christ, but making sure or trying to call Israel to repent and get that nation straight so that the fulfillment of God's prophetic purpose with Israel will come to pass. Come back with me if you would. To get 1 Corinthians in one hand and Galatians 2 in the other. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 in one hand and Galatians chapter 2 in the other. For 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 17, Christ sent me not to baptize but to preach. Was Peter sent to baptize?
No.
Peter was, right? What does Peter say? Men and brethren, what should we do? What should we do? We killed the Prince of Life. What are we supposed to do? Repent and be what?
Baptized.
For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to what? Preach the gospel, he says, okay? So we already know from previous study that the gospel that Paul preached had nothing to do with what? Baptism, right? But more so than that, it has to do with the cross, and it has to do with the meaning of the cross in a way that Peter never talked about in Acts 1 through 7 and in the early chapters of the book of Acts. And notice that this gospel has something to do with the cross, lest the cross of Christ be made of none effect. Verse 18, it's the preaching of the cross. Come with me now to Galatians chapter 2. Get caught up here, sorry. Galatians chapter 2. Verse 7, but let's look at this. Go back up to verse 1. Then 14 years after, I, that's Paul, went up to Jerusalem with Barnabas and took Titus with me also. And I went up by what? Did God tell Paul to go? And communicated unto them, notice, the gospel which I preached among the Gentiles. What gospel is that? That's the gospel we just read in Acts 13, where they could believe on Christ and be justified from all things which they cannot be justified by the law of Moses, right? That's the gospel Paul was preaching, and the gospel Paul was preaching had something to do with the cross work of Christ. The rest of the verse, but privately to them which are of reputation, lest by any means I should run or had run in vain, but neither Titus who was with me being a Greek was compelled to be circumcised, and that because of false brethren unawares brought in who came in privily to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ, that they might bring us into bondage, to whom we gave subjection to, I'm sorry, to whom we gave place by subjection, no, not for an hour, that the truth of the gospel might continue with you. But of these who seem to be somewhat whatsoever they were, it maketh no matter to me. God accepteth no man's person. For they who seem to be somewhat in confidence added what?
Nothing.
Did anybody at that Jerusalem council meeting tell Paul anything he didn't already know? No. What's the first word of the next verse? What's the first word of verse 7? But contrariwise. Okay, so verse 6 says, Paul says, hey, they didn't tell, whether publicly or in private, they didn't tell me anything I didn't already want. But contrarywise. So that means then, does Paul tell them some things that they didn't already know? But contrarywise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto who? Folks, in your King James Bible there, do you have two different gospels? You have the gospel of the circumcision committed to who? Peter, and you have the gospel of the uncircumcision committed to who? Did I just demonstrate to you plainly from the Word of God that Peter in the early Acts period has a lot different things to say about the cross than what Paul had to say about the cross? Now I understand that may fly in the face of your church tradition, but the Word of God is clear that these two men have separate apostleships, they have separate commissionings, they have different gospel messages, and it all relates to what God is doing dispensationally. Come back to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. So let's talk in our third point about the preaching of the cross in 1 Corinthians 1. So what I've tried to do is kind of expand out, show you sort of the big picture about this, look at a dispensational contrast, and now understand some things specifically about this verse. Now, it's clear here, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it's the power of God. It's clear to me, as I think about this verse and the context that we've looked at so far, okay, that in 1 Corinthians, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul's dealing with some fundamental aspects of the preaching of the cross, most importantly, i.e. justification and salvation, right? Now, when I say justification and salvation, I'm talking about you. I'm talking about the lost sinner passing from death to life. I'm talking about that lost person hearing the gospel that Paul's preaching, believing it, and trusting it to the eternal salvation of their soul. Okay? That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a basic element of the preaching of the cross. What I tried to show you in the first point is that preaching of the cross, yes, it includes that basic element, but it also includes a whole lot more that would fall under that umbrella term, okay? But here, he means something very simple, very plain, very basic, if you will. Look at what it says. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish, what? Foolishness. The Greek word translated perish here occurs 93 times in the Greek text supporting the King James Bible. It's variously rendered by the translators as perish 33 times, destroy 26 times, lost 5 times, be lost 5 times, and lost 4 times. So that gives you, at least just without looking at all these things, which would take forever, just a little understanding of what they've done here when they translated your English Bible. According to Webster's 1828 dictionary, the word perish carries the following meanings. There's 10 meanings here. I'm not going to read all of them, just a couple of them. Number one, to die. To lose life in any manner applied to animals. Men perish by disease or decay, by the sword, by drowning, by hunger or famine. To die, to wither and decay, applied to plants, to waste away as a leg or an arm perished, to be in a state of decay or passing away, to be destroyed, to come to nothing. The tenth meaning, look at the tenth meaning. The tenth meaning means to be lost, how? Eternally, okay? To be sentenced to endless misery. And then the English dictionary gives you 2 Peter chapter 3 to look at to understand that meaning. So why don't we go, let's go to 2 Peter chapter 3 and let's look at verse 9. Second Peter chapter 3, verse 9. Second Peter chapter 3, verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning His promise. Hope this is the verse I wanted. As some men count slackness, but as long-suffering to us, not willing that any should what? Perish. Folks, is the fact true? That's redundant. The fact is obviously true, or it wouldn't be a fact. Is it a fact that God does not desire that any should perish? Will people perish? Yes. Why will they perish? Will they perish because God has foreordained and said, oh, I like this half of the room and I don't like this half. I died for your sins. I didn't die for your sins. Yeah. I elected you before the foundation of the world, but I didn't. I just tough luck for you guys over here, you reprobates. Okay, is that what? No. The reason people perish is because they choose of their own volition to reject the preaching of the cross. Right? That's why they perish. When Paul talks about perish here, go back to 1 Corinthians. When he talks about perish here, he's talking about, and I believe he's using it in the sense of being lost eternally. So think about the verse. The preaching of the cross is to them that what? Perish, what is it?
Foolishness.
It's foolishness. I believe that when Paul's speaking here about them that perish, he's clearly speaking about lost, i.e., or unsaved what? Does an unsaved man appreciate the preaching of the cross? Just think about that. As a general rule, does an unsaved man hear the fact that Christ died for his sins and so forth, and does he say, oh yes, I'm such a sinner, I so need a Savior? Or does he say, you guys are a bunch of idiots. You kidding me? That's his attitude, right? Or her attitude of a lost man or woman. But look at what it says in the verse there. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish. What's the next word after perish? Foolishness. This is so interesting to me. Please note the following definitions of the English word foolishness. Number one, folly, want of understanding. Doesn't Romans 1 say that God turned the Gentiles over to a reprobate mind? To do those things which are not convenient? Doesn't Romans 1 say that man knew who God was and didn't want to retain God in his knowledge? And so as a result, he gave him over to this reprobate mind? Okay? So did man start out knowing who God was? Absolutely, right? They knew who God was. They could see the handiwork of God in creation and so on and so forth. And they knew who God was. And the problem is they didn't want to...